Hey there, and welcome to the Debt Free Guys first Facebook Live of 2019. I should say on the Debt Free Guys feed, many of you are aware that we do weekly Facebook Lives in the Queer Money Group. But this week, we're starting something special. This is part of a three-part series. But I want to ask you a question. We're posting a poll here. Want to ask you, do you ever find it easy to overspend when it comes to social, going out to dinner or hanging out with your friends? Do you find it easy to do that? I think that the vast majority of us do, right? So just think about it. What happens if you overspend by just $100? Probably not a big deal. Overspend by $100 a month, not a big deal. What happens if you do that every single month? You put that money on your credit cards and all of a sudden, bang, at the end of the year, you have $1,200 on your credit card. At 20% interest, it's gonna cost you $250 a year to just have that on that credit card. Imagine what you could do in your social life if you had an extra $250. That would be a lot of extra money, right? That's like an extra $20 a month. That's two times out to Chipotle every month.
Put it in terms that we can understand.
Exactly. Evidently, I'm hungry for Chipotle.
So that's what we're going to talk about today. The idea of not letting our social life take over our budget. Because very often we found in the work that we've done with the LGBT community ourselves and the work that we've done with different brand partners such as Prudential and MassMutual, that our community spends a lot of money on our social life. It becomes, it's an ongoing concern. So what would it be like if you didn't have to worry about debt from month to month? What would it be like if you didn't have to worry about the credit collectors calling? Or I imagine a lot of you are like David and I used to be, where we didn't even look at our credit card statements because we knew they were bad and we didn't need to know how bad they were. What would it feel like if you were saving for a financially secure retirement? What would it feel like if you did have, as David said, an extra $1,200 or $2,000 to put towards your social life? I mean, that's, you know, you save that in a year's time. That's a vacation to Puerto Vallarta. So that's part of what we're talking about today. We know, as I said, from all those different studies, anecdotally, and from the larger financial services firms, that there are three top concerns in the LGBT community when it comes to our finances. And they aren't necessarily in this order, but the number one concern, by and large, most financial services firms uncover is that we want to pay off our credit card debt, which I think is quite surprising. Even as much as we have the escalating student loan crisis, still credit card debt is the leading financial concern of our community. We also want to save for a comfortable and secure retirement. And I think a lot of us aren't necessarily on the path to that, and that's part of what's stressing us out financially and mentally and physically. And then we also want to have a better quality of life today. There's this perverse perception that we either have to save for tomorrow or we can have a good life today. And that's not the case. As David and I have learned from our own experiences, and part of what we're going to share with you today, is that you can actually do both in tandem. It just requires a little bit of planning, which is much of what we're going to talk about today.
Right. But when we think about that, wanting to have that great life, I think a lot of us think, especially gay men, think it's expensive. Why is it so expensive to be gay? I mean, when you think about it, look at the way the media in general depicts gay men, especially the gay community in general, but gay men especially. We live in penthouses in New York off the park. We take amazing vacations. We drive the best cars. All of this is kind of this perception or this kind of pressure that we get put on us by the media to be fabulous, right? I mean, anecdotally, we have found this is the sentiment in our community. You know, for example, several of the Facebook groups that we're a part of, one person, Christian, he actually asked the question to the group of 55,000 people. He asked the question, why is it so expensive to be gay? Clearly, a lot of us have this feeling like it is expensive. Justin, another person in the group, said, why do we as a gay community hold ourselves and each other to toxic levels of beauty, perfection and masculinity. It costs a lot of money to have the perfect body, the perfect skin, the perfect hair. You know, it costs.
This is the perfect right,
that is actually the perfect hair. Super cheap. Anyway, it costs a lot of money to live up to this expectation. Yeah, Wayne even made this comment. He said, "We insist on having the finest of everything. If you buy into that, you're going to spend a lot of money. If you say fuck that, you'll find that you'll have a lot of cash." So Wayne's got a little bit of a good of the right idea here, that maybe we shouldn't be necessarily buying into this idea that as a community we need to be uber fabulous.
Well, I think there's this myopic perception of what fabulous is, and there's different definitions of that. And I think we in our community need to start taking control of how are we going to define that. Let's not let the media, let's not let history define what a fabulous gay person is. I mean, we're all different kinds and makes and models, and each one of us is fabulous in our own way. We don't necessarily need to live up to all these expectations. So for those of you who don't know, I'm John.
And I'm David.
And we're the Dad Free Guys and co-hosts of the Queer Money Podcast and the creators of the Credit Card Payoff Course, which is coming out in about almost 2 weeks, January 13th. So look out for more information on that coming now. But our story is that about a year and a half after David and I started dating, we sort of had a come to Jesus moment where we realized that between the two of us, we had $51,000 worth of credit card debt. And the irony was, at the time, we had about 15 years of combined tenure in financial services. So here we were helping other people with their money, but we weren't helping ourselves. And that was taking us on a path of financial disaster. So we figured out a way, we created a plan to pay off our debt using both our personal and professional experience.
There goes the kitty cat.
To pay off our debt. And now we're trying to share that with our community because, as we said earlier, we know a leading financial concern in our community is credit card debt. And that was exactly our concern. So we want to help people pay off their debt with that strategy. So what we're going to talk about today is taking control of your life and money in 2019. This is the first of a three-part series that we're doing on the Debt Free Guys wall. We'll do the next two episodes later on, next week, and we'll provide you with more information on that a little bit later.
Right. By the way, welcome. This is Max. He's evidently our guest again. Well, now he's gone. Anyway, so as we mentioned earlier, there is this perception of who we need to be or what we like to be in the gay community, right? Or the LGBTQ community. One of our biggest challenges is that we love to be social. Now, why is that? Well, when you really think about it, I think that a lot of us, especially those of us who are maybe a slightly older or come from certain parts of the country, we didn't experience when we were in junior high and high school being a part of a group. Oftentimes we were outcasts. We just didn't feel comfortable being around particular groups. We didn't feel like we could be ourselves. So as we have progressed, we have been able to find our community and we've been able to have this kind of social life that we really, really want. But what's interesting is that today we seem to have to spend a lot of money to have that social life. And it, unfortunately, it's that social life that is driving a lot of us into debt. When you really think about it, some of the things that we spend the most amount of money on are dining out, hygiene, which of course I think is done because we're going to go out and hang out with our friends, right? We spend a lot of money on activities that kind of give us this opportunity to share with our friends that we are fabulous, that we're great, and it costs us a lot. So what happens if you can, what can you do if you can enjoy a great social life, but you can do it without having to take on any debt? What if you could do it without having to spend an extra $100 a month? What is really going to happen? Well, if you master having a great life without having to spend extra money, without having to take on debt, you're going to find that you'll stress less. We already know that debt causes stress. There's tons of proof out there that shows that. And our community is taking on more debt than our straight peers. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that we like to go out to dinner. We like to go out and hang out with our friends. We like to take fabulous vacations. All of these kinds of things add to that. So we put ourselves under a lot of stress. So if we can do it, we'll reduce the amount of stress. We'll actually find that we're happier because we're spending time doing the things we love, right? Rather than spending money to make people think that we have a great, fabulous life.
You'll Hi, Joseph.
You'll also find that you're going to be more financially secure. If you can maintain a great life without having to go into debt, then your life is going to start to improve financially. When you become more secure financially, you feel better about yourself. When you feel better about yourself, you're going to have a better night's sleep. That is one of the biggest things, is that our community says that they worry about, 50% of us worry about debt or money issues on a weekly basis. And that is causing us to not be able to sleep. The other thing it's causing us is it's causing us to not have great relationships. When you start to take care of yourself financially, you start to have a better relationship, especially with the people that you love.
No. And as we know from Prudential's 2018 financial wellness census, all of this financial stress is having an adverse effect on our physical and mental health. And we know that's a big problem in the LGBT community. So this isn't just trying to pay off credit card debt or just trying to have a secure retirement. It's actually affecting your physical and mental health. And that's there's really nothing more important than that. So what we're going to talk about today will help you master the art of balancing your finances with also having a fabulous life. You'll be able to start saving more money, stop increasing debt right away. And the goal here is really just to help our community to stop acquiring debt, start freeing up cash for us to pay off existing debt or to manage our time better, and also specifically manage our finances better. When Dave and I sort of created this strategy, we were with where I think a lot of people are today. We had our $51,000 worth of credit card debt, and we did some introspection over the several years while we were paying off that debt and trying to figure out, well, how did we get here? Mm-hmm. Here we are, financial services professionals, theoretically, who know supposed to know what they're doing, and we were a mess personally. And we found that we think it's based on two reasons. One, because we came from a time and a place when it wasn't okay to be gay. When we finally were out on our own, out from underneath our parents' roof, paying for our own bills, we could finally be ourselves. So we wanted to make up for lost time and celebrate on the idea that we were finally on our own, and we could actually be ourselves. But then we also could we found our new community of LGBT people, and we tried so desperately to fit in with them. We were afraid that if we didn't have the right clothing, didn't take the right vacations, didn't have the right cars, that our new community would also ostracize us, because that's just what we were familiar with. We were familiar with not being included. And for those two reasons, we think that by and large, for those two reasons, that's how we got into our credit card debt. And so we want to help our community overcome those sort of expectations, the sort of what we call overspending to overcompensate, the need to have the right clothing, the need to shop at the right grocery stores. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about today, but we want to dive a little bit into how we actually got to the point where we decided to finally pay off our credit card debt.
Yeah, I think a lot of you wonder, what is it going to take? How do you get to that point? Well, I'll tell you how it is that we got to that point. Some of you may have heard this story, but I know that a lot of you have not. So one day, John and I, we had been together for probably about a year and a half, decided to go up to Winter Park, Colorado, which is a great little ski resort town here in Colorado. John had a friend. He and his girlfriend lived up there. We went up there to hang out with them for the weekend. We live in Denver. And so we went up to the mountains, had a great weekend hanging out with Dan and Lindsay, and we decided that we really liked Winter Park, and we could picture ourselves having a vacation home there. So on the way out of,
that cat was sleeping all day long. And when we started this video, it now can't stop moving around.
So anyway, on our way out of town, we decided to stop at a real estate office and check out property. You know, I've always wanted to buy land and build a modern home, one that I love. So we were on this high heading out of town with this whole fantasy idea that we were going to buy land and build a house up there. Fortunately, we were locked in a car together on the highway for an hour and a half drive home. We went from being on that high of 9,200 feet in Winter Park. As we drove down to Denver, our conversation changed from being able to buy land and build a house to maybe buy a condo there to maybe we shouldn't even be going up there for vacations. And finally, we pull into our place in Denver, park the car, get out, walk down a flight of stairs into a basement apartment. It was at that point that we said to each other, we are living physically and financially in a hole. And we realized that we needed to come clean with each other. We couldn't afford to have the life that we wanted, not because we weren't making enough money, but because we were living a reckless, unconscious lifestyle of how we were spending. And the vast majority of that was food, dining out, going out with our friends. Most of it was our social life because we felt like we needed to overcompensate.
Exactly. It was all a lot of spending to make ourselves feel better and to make ourselves feel validated. And that was a very costly mistake. But that story doesn't stop with us. Your battery's running low. We made these changes to better manage our time and our money. But now that's why we want to share this with you, because we know it works. We know it can help many of you, because it sounds like from the anecdotal research and the official research from these financial services partners that we work with, that these are the same problems that our community have. We want to help you overcome balancing the fun and the finances to start living debt-free. So if you haven't done so already, go ahead and download the Living Fabulously Social Life Calendar. We're going to go through step by step our strategy for filling this out. And we'll preface, this isn't rocket science here. This is a simple solution. But the problem with it is that it's so simple, so many of us simply don't do it.
Yes.
And all the whole idea with this is simply planning. What is that cat doing? So go ahead and download the Living Fabulously Social Life Calendar. The link is above, I think. And then we're going to start walking you through this. So the idea here is to plan your social life around your budget. I know that a lot of people don't have a budget, or if they have one, they don't necessarily stick with it, or they don't know how to actually implement it into their day-to-day lives. And this is kind of where you can pull the two together, pull your social life calendar and your budget together to kind of figure out how to manage your budget day-to-day basis in your life. This is all predicated on being financially conscious of your budget. So you'll notice when you download the Social Life Planner the calendar, at the bottom, there's a whole section for you to input money information. So we want to have full and complete awareness of our financial situation so that we can schedule our social life accordingly. So you'll see there's a place for you. And the idea here too is to don't sit down in January and start planning January. The idea is to maybe plan these a month or two in advance so that you can make sure that you don't overblow your budget. So go ahead and fill out your projected monthly expenses, your projected monthly income. And David has some tips on how to manage those two.
Right. So one of the things that a lot of us forget to do is to send the money before we spend it. There's this whole idea of having more month than money. And a lot of times the reason that happens is because we forget that we have certain bills due during certain times of the month. And we do our social spending. We go out, we buy certain things. And then all of a sudden we realize, oh, that's right, I have this bill due and I have that bill due. Well, if we send our money before we spend it, send money on those bills that you need to. The way I did this for us was, as soon as I got paid or we got paid, we sent those bills, that bill money out immediately. That way we knew what was left over. That was the money that we had to be able to say yes to dining out or no to spending extra money on gourmet food at the grocery store. It became easier for us to understand how to manage our expenses. One of the other things that we did is we started to shift to this idea of doing things that were not as expensive. Like there were ways, John and I enjoy wine, so we would buy cheaper bottles of wine, or we would find ways to go out and do things socially that were cheaper. So we focus on this idea of things not needing to be as fabulous as everybody else expected them to be.
Yeah, we did a little bit of investigative research here with regard to the wine. Before we were drinking expensive California wines, and then we realized there are some great international wines that are $12 and below. So that still helped us have a good quality of life, but it wasn't as expensive as the spending that we were doing prior to that. And one of the other benefits with David's strategy of sending it before spending it, is that I know that a lot of us are concerned about our credit score. And part of the reason why our credit score is bad is that we're either miss or are late on payments. And sending your bill payments well in advance of when they're due guarantees that you pay them on time, but also pays them in advance, which can improve your credit score over time. Likewise, go ahead and fill out on the finance section, complete your budgeted monthly social spending. Now, budgeting your monthly social spending on a monthly basis can seem somewhat daunting, but another trick that we have for people is what we call money chunking. And that idea is that you want to be able to spread out your social spending throughout the two-week period that you're paid or the month-long period that you're paid, whatever pay cycle that you're on. So for example, if you know that you have a $200 budget for the next 2 weeks, well, you don't want to spend that $200 on the next Friday night out. Otherwise, the rest of the 14 days, you're stuck inside doing nothing, and that can be kind of boring. So the idea...
It can also lead you to just go ahead and doing things and spending it on your credit card.
Right, exactly, which too many of us have done. So the idea there is to, if you've got two weekends or four weekend days that you want to spend your $200, divide that by four and give yourselves $50 per time that you go out or per night that you go out. That's way you can ensure that you have money for each of the different events that you want to do. Also, because we want to be cognizant of our finances, if you have debt, list your debt in that section as well. We always want to keep that in the forefront of your mind. Being conscious and aware of it can help you stick with a budget and work toward paying it off. And then you also want to document your net worth. And hopefully over time, as you're using this strategy, your net worth, even if your savings and investment don't increase, hopefully at least the idea that you're spending down or paying down your debt will help increase your net worth.
Right. So the second thing you want to do after you kind of have this idea of what you're going to spend, you have your social spending amount, is you want to start to plug things into the calendar. So oftentimes we feel an obligation to do things socially. And so what we want you to do is to focus on the ones that you have these you feel like you have these obligations to. So things like birthdays, holidays, anniversaries, special occasions. Oftentimes these are the people that mean the most to us. Whether it's our biological family or our logical family, we feel the need to be with these people, right? So we want to spend time with them. And oftentimes when we spend time with them, that means we're going to spend money. So one of the things we want to encourage you to do is to do these group activities with your friends or your family, because it gives you a big impact. You get to have or spend time around a lot of people at one time. And that way you feel like you're spending time with a significant number of people. You're doing things socially with a significant number of people, and you can do it on fewer occasions. The other thing to remember is that not everybody's birthday is a reason for you to go balls to the walls, right? You need to remember that you have responsibilities as an individual to your bills, to your family, to your home. Those kinds of responsibilities,
those
come first before someone else's birthday, right? And if you're like us, I don't know why, we have a couple of friends who seem like no matter what, their birthday needs to be an all-out party every single year. Well, we basically have had to say, no, not this year. We're going to do it every 5 years or something like that. So it's okay to say no. The other thing is remember that you don't always need to buy the best gift, the nicest card. Sometimes it's simply being there that is the most important thing. Sometimes if you can't be there, just simply calling them, texting them, being social with them in some other manner can provide the opportunity to be with that person.
And I'm going to take a bit of a break here. The way Facebook's new Facebook Live is set up, we can't see if you're commenting or asking questions. We want to answer all your questions. So if we're not able to do it real time, we'll do so afterward. But it's hard for us to see who's commenting, if at all. So please ask all your questions, and we'll be sure to answer them somehow. It's kind of inconvenient how they've set this up, but we're going to continue. So the third step in completing this Living Fabulous Social Life calendar is to then incorporate the gay or LGBT must-dos. You're already going to make sure you spend the right time with your friends and family, but you also want to, we know that there are some LGBT events that you absolutely have to get to. Pride, for example, is probably one that you're never going to want to miss. We know that there are special events. Every weekend there's a special event at the clubs and bars, though not every special event at the clubs and bars is maybe necessarily important for you. So figure out which ones are important to you and then go ahead and add those to your calendar. It might be that your friend is a club promoter and you want to make sure you go and support them, or there's a particular DJ coming into town. Well, planning that out ensures that you go to the right events where you get the most value from, and likely are going to see the most other LGBT people, most of your friends. And this can help avoid the question that we used to get when we first were trying to figure out the best strategy to have a good social life was, where have you guys been? We thought you guys died, or we thought you moved away. So if you go out to the most important events for you, or the most efficient time to see most of your friends, then you can avoid those questions, because you're not going to the bar every weekend. You're only going when the most people are going to be out, or when you know that you're going to get the most value out of it.
Right. So our fourth item here is one that, of course, I love, and that is plan free and cheap activities. There are a shitload of things that you can do for free. You don't need to always spend a ton of money on having fun. You know, even some of the things that you're already doing, like, let's say, for example, doing a watch party, getting together and watching a movie on Netflix or Hulu, Amazon, or if you or one of your friends has cable and you want to watch Drag Race as a group, do that. You don't need to go to the bar and drop $50 on drinks just to watch Drag Race. Spend $12 on a bottle of wine or a six pack of beer and have your friends come over. Do a potluck. There's also 2-for-1 movies. There's Groupon, entertainment book. All those kinds of things allow you to do the things that you want to do, but be able to do them for a little bit less. And when you do that, when you shave off that 10%, 15%, 20% off of the activities that you are already doing, that's where you have the extra money to pay off your debt. That's where you have the extra money to create an emergency savings account. That's where you have the extra money to start investing. That's how you end up getting wealthy.
Exactly. And as David is talking, I can totally hear a bunch of people saying, "None, this is not groundbreaking." And it's not. The problem is that we don't actually use this strategy. We don't actually plan ahead. So we're kind of unconsciously just going along with a crowd and saying, "Well, I guess I will go to the club tonight to watch Pose because I didn't plan anything else to do, and I want to have fun, and I don't want to be stuck home bored by myself." But if you plan this out far enough in advance, you can have that watch party over at your house. You can max out your spending to about $20. And again, it's not groundbreaking, but so many of us don't do it because it is so easy. So then our fifth recommendation is to then add to your strategy, find the websites in your area that have a specialty in offering or highlighting the free and cheap things to do in your area. So for example, here in Denver, we have milehighonthecheap.com, where they list all sorts of free and cheap things going on all throughout the Denver metro area. So they do that, they update that real time. And so we can see who's coming into town, or what free concerts happening, or what events happening at the library that we actually might want to go to. And then we plan that, add that to our calendar in advance, so we know what we're going to do several weeks to a month ahead of time. In Philadelphia, where we visit a lot, there's the Philly Fun Guide. In New York City, where we also go a lot, is theskint.com. And then there's also Living on the Cheap, which covers several cities around the country.
Actually, they have 25 different cities that they have that they catalog different things that you can do that are cheap or free.
Exactly. And then there might be other specialty sites in your area that offer similar information. find out what those are and make that a regular habit to look and see what's coming up, and then making sure you're jotting on your Living Fabulously social life calendar those events, so that one, you don't miss them, and then two, you've got something free or cheap to do with yourself rather than going out and spending, going to the bar and spending several hundred dollars because you're drinking out of boredom, which we've been known to do. So again, like I said, this is not groundbreaking, but it's just actually having a strategy and a process to manage your social life so that you can have a good time, but also stick with your budget.
Yeah, you definitely want to plan ahead. So what happens when you master this? What is it going to look like? What are you going to see happening in your life? You're going to start to overcome some of those emotions that we talked about earlier. You're going to start feeling, you're going to stop feeling less than. You're going to stop trying to make up for lost time, start trying to fit in. And you're going to stop searching for validation from individuals. You're going to start taking care of yourself because you're going to be focused on having fun, doing the things that you love to do.
So that it's a great segue into what we're going to talk about on the next DFG Live next Tuesday, January 8th. It'll be episode two, part two of this three-part series, Taking Control of Your Life and Money in 2019. Planning is a great way to sort of overcome some of those emotions because you're strategically and methodically implementing a process. But no amount of planning is going to be able to make those emotions go away. And David and I know this from experience, and we're still trying to work to overcome limiting beliefs about ourselves, about what we're worth, and about correcting our own money mindset. So that's what we want to dive into next week. We're going to share with you our strategy for overcoming that. It includes the Living Fabulously Daily Journal, which has five steps that David and I, for the most part, practice daily on a religiously to help overcome some of those feelings of inferiority, those feelings of inadequacy. It's a long slog, but these are great tips that work for us. And we know they've worked for several other people. So we want to share that with you next Tuesday, January 8th, 2019. will be the second of this three-part series. So join us for that. It'll be the same location. Oh, that's you.
Yeah. So before you go, we have a favor to ask. We want you in the comments here to tell us one thing that you will add to your Living Fabulously social life calendar. One activity that you can see yourself doing that you know will allow you to spend less. And then think about one activity that maybe is a habit, something that you do regularly. Add that activity as something you're going to cut down or cut out. You know, so for example, when John and I were in our heyday, we used to go out almost every night of the week. It was Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday afternoon. We were going out and doing things socially.
I don't know
with
how we
friends.
Did that.
Yeah, I don't know how we did it either.
I can barely go out one night a week now. Yeah,
exactly. So think about how you can replace a bad habit or an expensive habit. Maybe it's not bad, but maybe it's an expensive habit with something that's better or is going to cost you less. So remember, again, go ahead and click on the link, download the Social Life Fabulous Social Life Calendar. And remember that it's these little changes that you make, just implementing a habit like this, that is going to have a huge impact. Little by little, a little becomes a lot. Remember, we talked about it earlier. Just by overspending $100 a month, you're going to have $1,200 of credit card debt at the end of the year. And that at 20% is going to cost you $250 a year. I'm sure you would be able to give up a few things so you don't have to pay an extra $250 a year.
Exactly. So we did. Thank you for joining us. We appreciate having you again. We're going to try to answer all the questions that may or may not be down there. But please, as David said, share those points and ask any questions that you have. We appreciate having you, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.
Bye.
Well, actually, hold on. Yeah.